Barack Obama's new book, it has just come out this week. It's called A Promised Land. It spends quite a bit of time talking about his first term and the challenges that he faced. Now, the former president, he's done a couple of high-profile interviews promoting the memoir, including with Oprah, where he spoke about what Joe Biden will face once he takes the oath of office.
I think that what Joe and Kamala can do is to level set, to reestablish that we don't use the Justice Department, for example, to go after political enemies, that we don't mingle personal business interests with the business of government, that there's an expectation that the president doesn't routinely lie or reshape the truth to his own convenience, that he doesn't call journalists enemies of the state. Those kinds of things, which in some ways we became numb to over the last several years, I think that's the stuff that can be fixed, and Joe and Kamala will set a different tone.
And on 60 Minutes, the former president also spoke about the dangers of how President Trump is behaving in this very moment of time.
What, in your estimation, would our adversaries be thinking right now, Russia, China, about the fact that the transition is not moving forward?
Well, I think our adversaries have seen us weakened, not just as a consequence of this election, but over the last several years. We have these cleavages in the body politic that they're convinced they can exploit. There's the old adage that partisan politics should stop at the water's edge, right? That when it comes to our foreign policy, that it is the United States of America, not the divided states of America.
And in his book, Obama wrote about Joe Biden. Quote, I like the fact that Joe would be more than ready to serve as president if something had happened to me, and that it might reassure those who still worry that I was too young. Obama writing, what mattered most, though, was what my gut told me, that Joe was a decent, honest, and loyal. I believe he cared about ordinary people, and that when things got tough, I could trust him. I wouldn't be disappointed. So, with so much attention on the current transition, or maybe better said, the lack thereof, Obama also showers his predecessor with praise for helping with his own transition. Whether because of his respect for the institution, lessons from his father, bad memories of his own transition, or just basic decency, Obama writes that President Bush would end up doing all he could to make the 11 weeks between my election and his departure go smoothly. Obama also noted that the Bush daughters, Barbara and Jenna, rearranged their schedules to give Malia and Sasha their own tour. Obama also added, I promised myself that when the time came, I would treat my successor the same way, and he did. Well, I want to bring in my next guest, David Litt. He, a former speechwriter for President Obama and an author himself. His most recent book, Democracy, in One Book or Less. And David, I want to get to the book and where we are now, but it wasn't lip service, was it? I've spoke to other folks who were there who said the message came from the top, from the boss, that even though we didn't like how the election went in November, we were going to do everything possible for the country to basically avail ourselves to the Trump administration as best as possible.
You have to remember, President Trump, when he was campaigning, he was not just opposed to President Obama or the administration. And this is a guy who started his political career with the racist birther lie that the president was not born in this country. He campaigned saying that Obama literally founded ISIS. And yet, despite all of that, the marching orders that the president and his team gave to everyone in the White House were abundantly clear. Do everything you can to welcome the new administration in and make their job as easy as possible. And as the president, or as the former president, points out in his book, that's not a partisan issue. That is something that's about the security of the country and the integrity of our democracy.
You write about the health of a democracy, and I like the expression, it's like Tinkerbell. If you stop believing it, it's not going to be there at a certain point. To that end, I was watching 60 Minutes this past weekend, and I audibly breathed easier when I was hearing his voices and the people in the room with me the same way, even those that don't follow politics as closely as you and I do. Do you think that we are so tribalized that the idea of a return to norms won't be appreciated even across the aisle? Or are we so divisive that, you know, it's shirts and skins no matter what?
Well, I'd like to tell you that polarization is going to go away, but I don't think it will. Here's what I think may happen and should happen. What we saw with President Obama talking about his book, but also the country more broadly, what we've seen, perhaps even more important, from President-elect Joe Biden talking about the transition that he has planned, is this idea of putting the country first. We might have different ways of approaching the challenges that we face, but we're all Americans and we have to address our problems together. We're seeing the opposite of that happen from President Trump. He's waging an all-out war on the integrity of our elections. He's convinced some Republican voters that the elections were fraudulent, even though they clearly were not. His own administration agrees they were not. And most importantly, we're seeing Republican senators and lawmakers stay silent in the face of these extraordinary attacks on democracy. So ultimately, we as a country still are facing a fundamental question. The president-elect clearly believes that we can unify the country. He wants to do that. The former president clearly believes that that's the only way the country succeeds. But we still have a lot of holdouts, a lot of politicians who would rather put their party first. And ultimately, one of the big questions over the next several years is going to be, A, whether politicians put the country above their party, even as politics continues to be a contact sport, and B, whether voters continue to punish politicians at the ballot box who undermine our democracy. I think that's what we've seen so far, and I suspect we'll see it continue.
You write in your book about how the very notions of elections and the equity that attached to it, we could do it a lot better than we are now. And I think if anyone needs, a 101 course in it, we'll just see all this disputing legitimate elections and trying to disenfranchise votes. But a lot of this dealt with the possibility that the Democrats would hold not just the White House, but also potentially the House and the Senate. And depending on how the elections go in Georgia, at best, there'll be a 50-50 split. You've already seen some sitting Democrats saying they don't have an appetite here to pack the courts, or they don't have an appetite to, get rid of the filibuster, or even for that matter, give statehood to D.C. or Puerto Rico, et cetera. Things Republicans would do in a heartbeat, I think, if it was the shoe was on their foot. Is it unrealistic at this point to even examine getting rid of the Electoral College, even if it doesn't make any sense? Because there is no possible math in this current Congress that would support something like that?
Well, the Electoral College is really a state issue rather than a federal issue. You could pass a constitutional amendment that requires state legislatures, or you could work around the Electoral College with something called the Popular Vote Interstate Compact, which I go into some detail in the book, but I'll spare you here. The short version is states can figure out a way around this. And I think that is a more important lesson more broadly. At a moment when some of the most ambitious political reforms are going to be tough to get done at a federal level, regardless of how the Georgia Senate races turn out, states have a lot that they can do. We're seeing this already. State secretaries of state who are responsible for their elections have been standing up to the president, to the Republican Party in states like Michigan, Pennsylvania, but also Republicans in states like Georgia have been defending integrity of our elections. State legislatures can make voting a lot easier, not just in red states or swing states, but a blue state like New York, election administration there is a disaster. They are just not good at running elections historically. They can get a lot better. So I do think that when it comes to democracy reform, when it comes to making sure that each of us have the right to vote, and also that voting right is real in practice because each of us have access to the ballot, that our votes matter equally, a lot of that is going to turn from the federal government to state governments or to things that President-elect Biden can do through executive order that would make, for example, registration more easily accessible around the country. Other smaller issues you can do like that. With that, you can also have the Justice Department start to prosecute voting rights cases and defend voting rights, where this administration used the Justice Department to attack voting rights. So there's things you can do in the executive branch. There's things you can do with the states, even though at the legislative level, that may be a higher hill to climb than we were thinking it might be going into the election.
As usual, it's my fault because I go with the heavy, but it's a funny book also, Democracy in One Book or Less. And David, I always appreciate a few minutes with you. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
So we just spoke about President Obama. When we come back, I want you to listen to what Michelle Obama said, the former First Lady, railing against the president for the way, not only that he treated her husband, but also how he's behaving as we're about to change administrations.